Topical. All right.
Hello, Paul.
I watched your introductory video and I had sound.
Oh, did you? Okay. Yeah. Who knows what's up? Oh, yeah. Everybody's coming in. All right. Admit.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
All right. All coming in.
I just missed lost y'all.
Well, hello again, Michelle.
Stop following me. That's what I want to say.
Wait a minute. I started this one. You're following.
Oh, and I see my friend Dawn.
Hi, Michelle.
Your cabbage exhibit. Fabulous.
Well, it's not going to get a very good medal. It was kind of a lark, but I had a good time.
But it was so enjoyable. I just loved going through it, and can't wait to pick your brain about it. It was great.
As a postcard collector, I loved it too. So,
thank you.
You're here.
And I thought, do you find these anymore? So I went out on eBay. Could start my own display.
Isn't it wonderful what's out there?
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
It's one great thing about the Pacific Northwest that thematics and topicals are so popular out here compared with a lot of the rest of the country. Look at all the topical exhibits we have at our show here.
Oh. Do you? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Well, I have to admit, every time I see another exhibit, I come up with four or five new ideas for topical exhibits. I'm working on several in my head, and I'm thinking, I need to focus more. It's hard.
Yeah, we're not going to live long enough to get all those done.
I feel that every day, and I hate that. I have things to do.
Kevin. Well, there's Dick. Okay.
Okay, guys, I lost everyone's picture. Any suggestions here?
Well,
we don't have your picture either.
Yeah.
Right.
Usually at the bottom left, when you move your mouse, it says mute and video, start or stop video.
All right, I have none of that on here right now.
Okay, you might have to get back out and come back in, and where it will ask you if you want your video and audio on.
Okay, let me try that and see what happens here.
Carol, by the way, thank you on the last meeting of the little tip with your space bar that mutes you and then unmutes you when you hit the space bar. Hit the space bar again, it mutes you. So nice toggle switch.
Yeah, I've learned that from one meeting yesterday and then another one earlier today. So it's like, I got to remember that. It is handy.
There is another way you can use it. If you press down the space bar and hold it down, you're on. And as soon as you take it off, your finger off, you're back.
Right, muted. That's what she's saying, yeah. We're trying to say that. I don't know if that's what we said, but that's what we're trying to say.
No, actually, I think Keith was giving a different point, which I'm testing right now. So we'll see if I stop speaking, if I go immediately to mute.
Oh, okay. You're muted.
So it worked. So if I hold the space key down while I'm talking, and then when I'm done talking, I let go, it goes right back to mute.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so now I can see everybody, but there's still no picture of me, which is okay, you know.
Now you should have at the bottom of your screen to the left, you should see a mute button and a start
video. Okay.
If it says start video, press it.
Ah, there we go. Thank you.
Hi, Barbara.
Hey, Vera, how are you?
Doing well. Except we have really poor air quality here today from the
forest. Yeah, I was thinking about that. Oh, gosh. I was worried about you with that.
The sky is kind of orange and gray all at the same time.
Yay. It's awful.
But no forest fires near me, so that's good.
Thank God for that one.
Looked like there was a fire somewhere about halfway between Squim and Forks.
I'm not going to call.
There was one at Lake Crescent about a month ago. Oh. But I hadn't heard whether that was the current report.
Was showing up on the Washington State fire map.
Oh, okay. Could be.
It's nice to see Don Hammond in person instead of a picture in a magazine.
Thank you. I am a real person most days.
Vera, there's about 25 people that signed up.
It's nice to see you in your new house.
Yes, wonderful. Really wonderful here. Bye.
Be nice to be to have some shows physically to be an ambassador.
Yeah, Squim is a wonderful place, and I chose well for my retirement spot.
Okay, we've got 22 of the 25 signees. If you're ready to start, I am Carol Edholm. I'm hosting this presentation. Topical Stamps in Washington State Symbols by Vera Feltz. If you're in the wrong place, well, you can leave or just sit and enjoy the ride. Let's see, we are recording, so if anybody has an issue with recording, let me know. This way it goes on to our website for those who are not able to attend can see Vera's presentation. And Vera, I will turn it over to you.
All right, am I on for the share screen?
Yes.
We'll see if we can make this work then. All right, hopefully everyone can see the screen. And I really appreciate your coming. Thank you for joining the presentation and to SEAPEX for allowing it to happen. Most of you, it seems, are already topical collectors, so I won't talk very much about the difference between topical collecting and the other kinds of stamp collecting. But I'm thinking most of you probably started as country collectors and then added topical somewhere along the way. But in today, most new collectors seem to be starting with topicals and then perhaps branching to the more traditional kinds a little bit later. I'm going to mention just a few things about ATA at the end. Most of you may even be members already. The American Topical Association is a wonderful, wonderful resource for all areas of topical collecting. This particular stamp, the Greetings from Washington stamp, has a few topicals on it. The Mount Rainier in the background could be part of a mountains topic or a volcano topic or mountaineering. The apples in the foreground could be part of a fruit topic, which is a subset of gastronomy. And the Seattle skyline here could be part of architecture. The space needle in the foreground could be part of the broader space topic, which is one of the larger topics available. About state symbols, most US collectors know the state birds and flowers series from the early 1980s. So we know that each state has a state bird and a state flower. those were voted by the state legislatures and approved by the governors, by and large, to become the official state symbol. Most other states have other kinds of state symbols, like fossils, trees, mammals, beverages, all kinds of different topics that states have designated. Perhaps the most unusual state symbol I've come across is from New Mexico. They have an official state question. And the question is, red or green? It refers to what kind of chili do you want?
Oh.
But it truly is an official state symbol, the state question of New Mexico. Now, let's think about a little bit about the state symbols of Washington, but I want to do one more disclaimer. I've lived in this state and in the Northwest only a few months now, so my knowledge is not as great as it will be for those of you who've lived here a very long time. So if I mispronounce something or say something wrong, I hope you'll understand. So one of the most visible state symbols of any state is its flag. Washington has the only state flag with a green background, which was chosen because our unofficial state name is the Evergreen State. It has the state seal of Washington on the flag, and it is the only state flag to depict a U.S. president. On the Flags of Our Nation series here at the bottom, it shows a western hemlock, which is our state, a forest, which is our state tree. Washington has a state amphibian, the Pacific chorus frog. Stamps in the upper right corner show a variety of green and brown frogs, which is kind of appropriate because in Washington here, our state frogs can either be brown or green or even gray. This sound that we know a frog by is produced by puffing up the throat sac of the frog. This specific chorus frog puffs its sac up to 3 times of normal size. Postmarks and cancellations can really enrich topical collecting, and I've shown here the USPS digital color postmark for this particular stamp. It was issued in the Northwest here in Boise, Idaho in July of last year. The willow goldfinch is our state bird. It's also the state bird of about 4 other states, I believe. Most people in the temperate part of our country know the goldfinch as a bouncy little songbird that often visits our bird feeders. Choosing a certain bird like this is really a good way to approach a topical collecting of birds. There are over 22,000 bird stamps in the world, just far more than most of us could ever try to accumulate in our lifetime. So a good way to start might be with your state bird if you want to get your feet wet, so to speak, in collecting topicals. I've shown here a postcard in the upper right. It shows also our state flower. And at the bottom is a neat item that could be added to your collection, although it has no bird on the stamp. This is the statehood issue of 1939, celebrating the 50th anniversary of Washington, Montana, North Dakota, and South Dakota. But the cachet is it's a hand-drawn cachet, and it shows 2 willow goldfinches. Here in this state, we have a state dance, the square dance. It provided early pioneers with a lot of good recreation. I doubt if much square dancing is occurring right now in our time of social distancing, but it's really a part of the history of our country. The stamp here is probably the only stamp in the world that shows square dancing. I may be wrong about that, but square dancing is a uniquely American dance, and I don't think there are many other countries that would have recognized it on stamps. Postmarks and cancellations can really add a lot of interest to your topic. So I've shown a square dance postmark for the 11th Annual Gay and Lesbian Square Dance Convention. This is from 1994. We have a state endemic animal. We have only one endemic animal living in our state, and that's on the Olympic Peninsula, the Olympic marmot. So I don't think that particular marmot is shown on any stamp, but there is one US stamp here on the cover.
No, I guess not. I just get so disgusted.
Hey, they're using a free service to like complain about the pork.
Please mute yourself if you've got background noise.
Okay, thanks. The marmot
show. Now she stopped.
Volume has changed. No. Again, the audio. Sounds like it's there. I think you're maybe sitting in a bad spot. Have you tried sitting in other places?
No. Okay, maybe we're there.
I'll come downstairs.
So the marmot on the cover in the bottom right corner is a yellow-bellied marmot. It was part of the Alpine Tundra series. The other marmots here are not Olympic marmots, but they're from different parts of the world, different countries. So this is a great topic to expand beyond United States stamps, because I don't think you'll find the Olympic marmot on a US stamp. The steelhead trout is our state fish, and that again is a tough find for a stamp because most trout stamps are of the rainbow variety. Fishing is such a major industry in Washington. I'm a little surprised the salmon wasn't chosen as our state fish, but I don't know the politics behind the choice of a steelhead trout. If you're going to be collecting Washington state symbols, you may have to kind of move into the rainbow trout genre. The rainbow trout was shown on our wildlife conservation series in the 8-cent era. And there are many rainbow trout on conservation stamps put out by different states. The middle one here is from Minnesota. And the bottom one is an early New Jersey trout stamp. And you can see this pair has a misperforation on it. Our state fossil is the Columbian mammoth, a prehistoric woolly elephant. And many elephant collectors have expanded into the mammoth category. So it has become a pretty popular area of collecting. I've shown here a mammoth on a stamp from Nicaragua and a maxi card in the upper right corner showing a mammoth with the Native American stamp from 1991, I believe. And then the postcard on the bottom shows the Columbian mammoth as the Washington State fossil. So items like this are, like the postcard on the bottom, are in no way philatelic, but many collectors like to add them. We like to add them to our collection just to enrich in it. Our state flower is the coast rhododendron, a beautiful smallish pink and white flowered plant. And this was discovered by Westerners near Port Discovery in the late 1700s. The cover that I've shown you here is shows the state bird and flower series that I mentioned earlier. It's a Colorado silk cover. You could probably buy a cover like this for 50 cents or less from almost any stamp dealer in the country because it's a fairly common cover, but it does show both the coast red rhododendron flower and the willow goldfish. We have a state fruit, which is a nice thing for a gastronomic collector such as me. The upper right stamp here is a definitive U.S. stamp. And then we all probably recognize the 5-cent Johnny Appleseed stamp from about 30, 40 years ago in our country. Washington produces 42% of the apples grown in this country. So this was probably a good choice of our state fruit. You see a couple of other international stamps here. A little bit more artistic than some of the things the U.S. usually does these days. And across the bottom is a strip of the postcard, the 33-cent postcard stamp, showing four different varieties of apples. In the upper right here is a still life of Andrew Wyeth. And in the middle, we see a stamp from Belgium, again, presented a little more artistically than some of our stamps are. And in the bottom right is an Isaac Newton stamp from Mali, a really neat addition to an apple collection, but this stamp is also a neat addition to a scientific collection because Isaac Newton is famous in the legend of watching the apple fall from the tree to discover gravity, etc. So it's nice to bring other topics into your collection, and a stamp like this would be a good way of doing it. On the left is a Washington State apple advertising stamp. And if you want to learn more about these, check out the exhibits of our show, and you will see an entire exhibit using the about the various Washington Apple advertising stamps. It's considered a state revenue stamp, and a certain small sum was taken from the sale of apples from the grower and used to promote the fruit. In the bottom, I'm thinking this Cinderella item was probably a Zazzle production by an Apple computer aficionado. So not a true postage stamp, but items like this do add a lot of interest to your collection. Now, this was designated as a state gem in 1975, but some Washington legislator probably did not do his homework or her homework, because it's not a gemstone. Petrified wood is a fossil. But it was designated as a state symbol because in prehistoric times, there were many swampy areas over much of our state. And we do see remnants of petrified wood today at the Ginkgo Petrified Forest State Park right along the Columbia River in East Central Washington. In the bottom two items, I showed the petrified wood stamp, 10-cent stamp issued by the US. In the bottom corner, you'll see two Cinderella items. These were produced under auspices of the National Park Service and available at National Park gift shops and so forth. The left one is a stamp that was issued for the passport booklets. Some of you might know about the little passport booklets to the national parks. I've carried this one for more years than I like to think about. And it's a really nice item that a lot of stamp collectors like to extend their hobby with. I just discovered that on September 28th, 2014, I canceled this stamp for the Pacific Crest Trail at Port Angeles, Washington. So I was visiting out here at that time. And so a book like this or stamps like this, petrified forest stamp that you can buy from the Postal Service, are a nice little adjunct to your collection. The bottom right item is a patch. And I've seen many patches, cloth patches, in various philatelic exhibits, display exhibits where you can put non-philatelic items. So these are the kind of Cinderella items that make a nice addition to your collection. Our state insect is the green darner dragonfly. Students from more than 100 school districts participated in the selection of this insect, and it truly is a beautiful one. It's shown on stamps from many countries. And I wanted to show you the bottom item is the only item I have here from the U.S., which is a dragonfly cover, again, a Colorado silk cover for the Dragonfly Definitive that came out in 2009. Our state marine mammal is the orca whale. It's a really significant symbol of the cult of our Northwest Native American culture, because the killer whale, as this is also called, migrates through Puget Sound. Some of you might possibly have been on a whale watching trip out of Port Angeles or a nearby town to see these whales in person. This is a very popular topic for stamps, and many countries worldwide have issued it. You might recognize the design of the upper right stamp here. It was actually a joint issue with the U.S. when the U.S. has a similar stamp similar to this one issued by Russia. And Washington has a state oyster, a very small shellfish, but it is important in Native American culture here, and is a part of the shellfish industry that's important in Northwest Washington. This is also called the Olympia oyster, shoalwater oyster, western oyster, comes by various names. The top four stamps are oyster stamps from several different countries, including Canada. You may have seen this 4-cent definitive from Canada. It's appeared on a lot of mail to this country, as people might need to add a small surcharge to their domestic postage to mail something to the U.S. So the oyster is popular also with members of the gastronomic study unit of ATA. These top two stamps on the right show oysters being served. And then the JAPOS study unit of ATA, journalists, authors, and poets on stamps, many of their members probably have the bottom right stamp in their collection. It depicts a folk tale from the Republic of China. The top center is a poster stamp, a type of Cinderella stamp that was popular in especially Europe and also our country in the early 1900s. So this is probably about 100 years ago when the Narragansett Bay Oyster Company of Rhode Island was promoting the purchasing of oysters, and they had this stamp designed by an artist. And these are wonderful, wonderful additions to many kinds of topical collections and available in many, many topics, not just gastronomic topics like oysters. I've shown a kind of unusual item at the bottom left, which again is not truly philatelic. Seems to be a privately produced booklet cover advertising a chop, steak, and oyster house in New York. It doesn't mention on the cover what kind of stamps are in, were inside, but it is, but it just mentions there were 25 stamps. I picked the brains of members of our Straight Stamp Society here in Squim about this item, and someone came up with an idea of how or why it might have been produced. They noticed the address of 66 Maiden Lane, and our club member recalled that Herman Pat Hurst, who was an early promoter of stamp collector, of stamp collecting, a dealer, a wonderful philatelic writer, Pat Hurst had at one time his office or store on Maiden Lane in New York. So it's just a guess, just surmising, but thinking that this might have been a place that he enjoyed oysters, and that he knew the proprietor and perhaps was behind the production of that booklet cover. Washington State tree is the western hemlock. It's the largest species of hemlock and lives to be maybe 1,200 years old or more. It's grown only within about 60 miles, 100 kilometers along the Pacific coast in Washington, and also Oregon and British Columbia. So I've shown the Washington statehood stamp of 1989. It seems to have a small group of western hemlock trees on the island that's shown on this stamp. And also a postcard, again, not a philatelic item, but showing a little of the history of our pictures of various hemlock forests. And the last symbol that I'm showing stamps for is the state vegetable of Washington, the Walla Walla sweet onion. And I've shown you some onion stamps from many, many different countries of the world. And from New Zealand, in the bottom right corner, is the tasty kiwi onion dip. So a couple words about some state symbols of Washington that don't actually, that I don't have any stamps to show you, except this first one you'll recognize. We already talked about it a little bit on the state flag. This seal was designed by a jeweler in 1889, the year that Washington became a state. And the jeweler used an inkwell, a silver dollar, and a postage stamp to design it. So looking at the vignette of George Washington, it looked a little familiar to me. I went back and looked at some early U.S. stamps, and most of them that used this particular vignette were long after 1889. The only one I discovered that was issued before 1889 was, I think, U.S. Scott number 39, the 90-cent blue Washington stamp, which most of us do not have in our collections, unfortunately. It's quite pricey, but it seemed to me that this was the vignette that might have been used to design Washington State Seal. Again, I'm just surmising, but it's fun to think about. The Washington State Quarter, issued in 2007, shows a leaping salmon, Mount Rainier, I believe it is, and supposedly western hemlocks, I think it would be western hemlocks along the base of Mount Rainier. And the date Washington became a state, 1889. Believe it or not, we even have a state tartan. This must have been a non-busy day in the Washington State Legislature, but it was part of the centennial celebration and probably produced by some group that was interested in tartans. A tartan is a twill type of fabric woven with the same stripes both vertical and horizontal. And in the lower left, I've shown the colors that are in this Washington State our Washington State tartan, which most of us never knew about. But it is the colors represent various physical features of Washington State, including black for the eruption of Mount St. Helens. Our state folk song is Roll On Columbia, Roll On, written by Woody Guthrie, a famous folk singer. Woody Guthrie also wrote This Land Is Our Land, This Land Is My Land. He wrote that in 1940 and apparently put it aside. It was not published till 1944. But in 1941, 1 year after the famous song was written, Woody Guthrie lived in Oklahoma, but was a well-known folk singer. And the WPA, the Works Progress Administration, up here in Washington, decided they needed some kind of publicity to make the building of dams popular. So they actually hired Woody Guthrie, brought him up to Washington, drove him up and down the Columbia River and all around the state, and commissioned him to write. And then he wrote over 20 folk songs about Washington and the building of the dams. The most popular of the ones he wrote seems to be Roll On Columbia, Roll On, and it was actually made the state folk song at a later date. So those of you from Washington probably have this song in your heart from back in second and third grade when your elementary school was teaching it to you in some kind of music class. And those of us who weren't from Washington can enjoy the beautiful scenery. As I think
Green Douglas fir where the waters cut through, down her wild mountains and canyons she flew, laden northwest to the ocean so blue, which roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Your power is turning our darkness to dawn. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Other great rivers add power to you. Yakima, Snake, and the Clickit Tattoo. Sandy, Willamette, and Hood River, too. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. It's there on your banks that we fought many a fight. Sheridan's boys and the blockhouse that night. They saw us in death, but never in flight. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Your power is turning our darkness to dawn.
So much for the Washington State symbols. And I thought I would just mention a little bit about ATA, the American Topical Association. Our new logo is shown here. ATA was formed in 1949. So it has a nice 70-year history now of helping topical collectors. Really a powerful history when we look at the 168 books that ATA has published through the years and over 400 issues of Topical Time and counting. ATA is the largest affiliate of the American Philatelic Society, and one of the best products is one of our topical checklists. We have almost 1,500 available now. And another great resource is the beginner and youth information that's free to everyone on our new website. I wanted to mention a little bit more about the checklist. As I said, there are over 1,500 available. And this is the item that you need if you're a beginning topical collector to help you find and discover the topical stamps that are out there. The Apples checklist has just over 500 items in it. And so if you wanted to collect that aspect of Washington State symbols, you could really get a lot of help from the list. You'll see it has the country name, excuse me here, has the country name, it has for each stamp, it has the date of issue, the denomination, and the Scott number. So the two things in bold, the country name and the Scott number, will be the most help when you're shopping for the stamp. And then there's also a description of the stamp, and you can make your little want list column there at the right. So just a powerful, powerful tool to any topical collector. And if you're collecting a topic like handkerchiefs on stamps, there's no ATA checklist for that. But if you have Jennifer at the ATA office create a handkerchief checklist for you to maybe put in your exhibit, that's something you need to illustrate handkerchiefs, she can do that. And I can tell you at last count, there are 3 handkerchiefs on stamps of the world, and Jennifer can find them for you. So just an example, whatever your topic is, no matter how obscure, I'm certain the ATA can help you. Wanted to mention the new ATA handbook. 54 different people contributed to this book. It was edited by our own Jack Congrove, who was just finishing up the editing at the time of his death in last spring. It is a wonderful, wonderful book. Go on to the ATA store on the website and get your copy today. No matter whether you're a very beginner in topical stamps or you're already exhibiting, you will find so much in this handbook to help you. It's going to be a great handbook for a long time, and I know you'll want to add it to your library. I thought I'd mention the ATA publications are related to Washington State, and you can extrapolate this to your state or whatever topic you are working in. We already talked about the checklists. I've illustrated ATA checklist number 1323, which is, you don't have to remember the number, of course, but just say you like the Washington State checklist. And it has not only US stamps related to your state, but stamps from all around the world. See the ones here, show Olympic National Park, Mount Rainier, lighthouses, etc., and they're from all different countries of the world, but they are related to topics that are from Washington State. Also, the album pages. This is a kind of often overlooked thing. ATA has several hundred album pages that are downloadable free from the website for all 50 states plus Puerto Rico, plus dozens and dozens of topics of any kind of subject you would think about. They're good for when you're just collecting a few stamps. Like for instance, I love lace on stamps, but I can't begin to take on one more topical collection. But I printed out the lace on stamps, and I have a place to put my half dozen sets of lace on stamps, even though I probably will hopefully not expand it too much in the future, just trying to cut down on my collecting, of course. Then there's also the Taste of Topicals, which is an often overlooked product. It's a beginner kit of 30 different stamps, 5 album pages, stamp hinges, and beginner information. The cost is only $5 for ATA member, for anyone, or $4 for ATA members. This is a labor of love on the part of many ATA members who've contributed stamps, hinges, and especially time to creating these Taste of Topicals kits. And you can go to the ATA website and find all the different topics that are available. And Washington State is one of the topics that's available. So no matter your topic, ATA will have undoubtedly a checklist, probably an album page, and possibly a taste of topicals for anything that you are interested in. ATA has had 58,646 total members in its 70 years. I checked with Jennifer this week, and that is accurate up to September 1st of this year. So thanks to those of you who are members, and hope the rest, anyone else who isn't, will join ATA to enrich your collecting. And I'd like to say thank you to SEAPEX for presenting this program, and remind you that you can Zoom into the ATA roundtable meeting an hour or so from now at 1 p.m. Pacific time today. Eric Knapp from Anchorage will be hosting that meeting. And I hope to see you in person at SEAPEX 2021, where ATA plans to be a convening society. So thanks for coming, and I'll be happy to take any questions. Let me stop sharing this program now. Okay, I'd be glad to take any questions anybody might have.
That was wonderful, Vera. Thank you very much. Anybody wants to ask questions, just unmute yourself. Wonderful presentation.
I've got a question and a comment. First of all, a shout out to Felix, who I hope is still here, who sent me this cover that represents a beautiful national bird of Puerto Rico. He sent it to me because I was beginning a collection of things postmarked on my birthday, and it was postmarked on my birthday in Puerto Rico, but it represents one of the ways that Vera's lovely topical collection could be extended. I also love that you showed us your passport stamp, and if we're exhibiting virtually, you could capture an image of that and include it as part of the collection of mm-hmm. the Washington State topicals. I just thought that was a wonderful idea that you had shown us. My question is, because there seems to be so many offshoots, apples and orcas and all these oysters and all these different, at what point do you stop? Does your topical collection on the state of Washington become a series of topical collections on all of these subcategories? How do you find control, I guess, is my big question.
Exactly. And that's I think all of us experience this, and it's just sort of self-control. I mean, we that's the beautiful part of stamp collecting. No one is telling us how to collect. We just decide, maybe we just want one stamp for all of Washington State symbols. But I kind of dare you to stop at just one, but each of us have to make that decision ourselves, and it just depends on how interested we are in the topic, etc., the kind of choices that we make. But at least that's my experience. Like I said, on lace stamps, for me, I would love to collect more, but you know, there is the budget to consider. And at one time, I promised my husband that I would not ever start another topical stamp collection. Well, in the end, I've added one more since then, which is World Heritage Sites. A tremendous topic, but I'm only collecting the stamp from the country where the World Heritage Site is. So, you know, you have to make your own choices, and each of us have our own parameters, budget being probably one of the first ones, yeah. But thank you for the compliment about the passport. I actually, just 5 minutes before this presentation, I went to my car where I always keep my passport and grabbed it out thinking, oh, well, maybe I should mention that. It's really a great item to do when you're a stamp collector. And you can populate your book, even without any postmarks, with stamps from the various national parks and the various, all the different series that the U.S. has had through the years. You can find a place to put them in your passport book. Then you have it handy whenever you get to the national park where you can cancel it.
Vera, did you also know that the Washington state flag is the only state flag that has the symbol, the correct direction on both sides of the flag?
I did not know that. Thank you for that, Keith.
Vera, you mentioned that postcards weren't considered philatelic. Well, I mean, I've had them in my my one and only exhibit, and I'm using them in my next one, and I always thought they were, but is it just the side where you put the stamp? I like them for the photos, to tell you the truth, and the images on them.
Well, it seems to me that the philatelic community is now in the process of bringing postcards into our hobby, and that's been happening for the last quite a few years. Postal cards, the ones that are printed by the governments, those have always been considered philatelic. Mm-hmm. But the picture postcards, Deltiology, that aspect of our hobby is kind of been assimilated in more recent times. Maybe some of you postcard collectors like Dawn can give a better answer than that.
Yes, postcards are now considered to be philatelic, and you can put them in any type of exhibit. Also, poster stamps are considered philatelic. I was told by a judge the basic definition is, was it made with the intent that it goes through the mail? And if the answer is yes, then it's philatelic. But we do also have a judge in the audience. Maybe Lisa would weigh in on that.
No, Don, your answer was correct.
So thanks. Of course. Dan corrected on that.
Thanks.
Any other questions or comments?
Go
ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Vera, for the presentation. Hopefully I'll see you again since we met, you know, the Atlanta show, and we shared some ice cream and some fried apples. So it was awesome. But what I liked was the connection, because Mississippi, our state stone, which is actual fossil, is also the petrified wood, and square dance is also our folk, you know, music, official dance down here. So I have those two stamps, so it's kind of interesting that we both share that two things.
Yeah, thank you, Felix. Great to see you. Yes, and we will one day meet again at a stamp show, I guarantee you. But many of the state symbols are shared between states. I believe 8 states, for instance, have the cardinal as the state bird. So it's fairly common to share it with some other states.
Uh-huh. There is a non-official state song too, and that is the Louie Louie.
Oh, I heard that. Yeah.
And I'd like to say to Dawn, it's nice to put a face with the name.
Thank you. I've been hearing wonderful things about the Ed Holmes for so many years. I had that same reaction. They're a couple of go-getters that do an awful lot for our hobby.
Absolutely.
And you've managed to pull off a virtual show to take over at the tragedy of Jack's death and make everything work. Congratulations to you and your committee.
Yes, we had lots of help. Everybody worked hard for it, which I really appreciate.
Carol and I have had a long time relationship. It goes way, way back. And when I moved out here and she asked me to be on the SEAPEX committee, I had no choice but to say yes. She has done so much for philately in this area. I just really have to be a part of it. So thanks, Carol, for everything.
Thank you for being a part of it. Thank you all for being a part of it. Lisa, Lori, definitely everybody.
Any other questions?
If we have a minute, I'll just add that in October, in celebration of National Stamp Collecting Month, the ATA is going to have a series of talks on Tuesday and Thursday evening and on Saturday throughout the month of October. We've got great variety, lots of different topics going to be covered, as well as some how-to type things. So watch the ATA website, and it should be about a week. Those programs will be posted and you can register, and we would love to keep up this virtual thing, which we're all enjoying so much.
Great.
Don, will that be Zoom?
Yes.
Like this?
Yes.
And register for specific ones?
Okay. That's right. Mm-hmm.
Good.
Vera, did you do the Washington state symbols as a result of moving there to learn more about the state, or were you doing that prior?
Previously, when I was working for ATA, I had done Missouri state symbols to represent ATA in giving talks in Missouri, and also Illinois, Tennessee, and Pennsylvania. So it was just kind of natural when I moved out here that I could extend my little collection of programs, I guess you'd say.
Is it is it assembled together as an exhibit?
No, I haven't exhibited. I haven't had time to exhibit. I've been too busy making programs and moving and all the rest. So.
Well, please consider it. I know the Evergreen Stamp Club would enjoy the exhibit during July, and SEAPEX would like to have it next year in September, I would think, because it's Washington, and we're Washington.
Really? I'll consider that. Thanks.
Lisa is very right. Yes, we would love to see it.
Absolutely, Vera. I'm sure you can find some time.
Which means I guess you get to start out at SQUIM with their small frames and do a couple frames there.
Sure.
I would like to say one thing. Can you hear me okay? That this Zoom meeting like this is absolutely fabulous. I have been to the I live in Eugene, which right now we're really locked down with the smoke. But not just for that, but I've been to the Portland PIPEX, you know, and how fun it was. It was so great meeting. It was like my tribe, because everybody cares about stamps. And I've been caring about mail since I was a child. So to miss that and not get to have our meeting has been difficult, and you all have made it. Here you are, and this presentation, I could hear it, Vera, way better than I would have in person. So I just really appreciate it all, and your topical. I used to be living in Washington for my whole life until 5 years ago. So the Washington topic is a great one. So thank y'all.
Well, I'm glad everybody could join us. This is just wonderful to actually put faces together with names that we've known for a long time.
I know, I was so excited when Vera moved to Washington. I figured we'd get to see so much more of her than we do just at national shows. And then we haven't got to see you at all. So this is the first time I've seen you since you've moved here.
It is, isn't it, Lisa? Right.
Yeah. Well, we saw it last year at SEAPEX. Did you not make it to SEAPEX last year?
Well, I had not moved at that time. My SEAPEX trip was a house hunting trip. So I was at SEAPEX a day and then came to look for a house. I didn't move here till first part of November.
That's right. That's right. Well, it's like you already moved here. What can I say?
Well, it is great to see everybody, and thank you for being a part of SEAPEX. It's so great that people from all over the country are joining us.
Yeah, it looks like our time's up. Any last minute questions for Vera?
Come to the Zoom this afternoon for ATA.
We'll be there.
See you then.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Vera.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you.